Chapter 3. Sixpence for a Baboon. This was a wonderful time for me, as I was allowed to do fairly well what I wished. Mr. Fisher would occasionally take me fishing on the river, and it was on one of these trips, while I was walking along the bank, that I noticed a branch of a tree move. Being a rather nervous child, I shouted for Mr. Fisher, who accused me of making a fuss about nothing, and immediately plunged into a bush next to the tree. Suddenly, I heard a scuffle and a rush through the undergrowth, and then Mr. Fisher was dragging me from the edge of the riverbank. When he got his breath back, he told me there was a huge snake in the tree and that I was to run to the hotel and tell my mother to send down as many people as possible with weapons. I was very excited and ran all the way. My mother rounded up half a dozen of the hotel staff who, with their spears, bows and arrows, knobkerries and long sticks, followed me back to the river. On our arrival, Mr. Fisher showed them a section of a large python lying in the tree, which was surrounded by thick bush. This bush was extended to the river's edge, where there was a ford, the water being about 18 inches deep over the crossing. A discussion started as to how the snake should be approached, but with all the noise and disturbance, the python decided to make the first move and began to slither to another clump of bushes further down the river. Two men dashed round and cut off its retreat, so it turned and went towards the water. This was what everyone was hoping for. The next thing I knew, Mr. Fisher was telling the man with the bow not to use his arrows any more, and the others not to spare it, as they would spoil the skin. During all this time, there was a tremendous amount of shouting and dashing around. I took fright and ran across the river about 50 feet wide, at this point, to a bit of open ground. But the snake had vanished. Everyone knew where it had entered the water, but had lost sight of it. A young Maasai boy next to me spotted it and shouted, "It's here!" He indicated a spot nearly 40 feet upstream. He threw a stone which hit the snake, but he kept moving. The cook, approaching the snake fast, went right up to it with his knobkerrie and long stick, which he used to lift the snake's head out of the water. He swung at it with the knobkerrie a couple of times and announced that it was dead. The python was dragged out of the river by its tail, and I summoned up enough courage to go closer. Just then it moved and someone shouted, "It's still alive!" Without any further ado, the area was cleared except for the cook and Mr. Fisher. One man in his haste sent me flying into the water, but had the goodness to turn and pull me out. I was screaming with both fright and pain, and Mr. Fisher quickly came over to me and said, "Don't be scared. It's only the snake's reflexes. The movement will go on for at least another half hour." He then took me by the hand and led me to it, and allowed me to knock it on the head with a knobkerrie to satisfy myself that it was indeed dead. There was great excitement among the staff. Everyone was talking at once. The only man who appeared calm was the cook, who stood aside in heroic silence. The snake was measured and found to be 22 feet long. There was a large lump in the center of its stomach, which, when it had been gutted, turned out to be a big hair, barely digested. The snake skin was later cured and hung on the wall in the main room, where it remained until the hotel was eventually sold. With the exception of a 28-foot python containing a whole bush book, I have not seen a bigger snake to this day. I was naturally very excited and wanted to know all about python. I was told that it normally lies up along a game trap, hidden in the bushes, where it is excellently camouflaged and waits for its prey. As soon as the animal is near enough, it strikes, biting very deep into the flesh and then immediately winding itself around the victim and crushing it. A python bite is not poisonous, but if not treated, the wound can go septic. The snake then covers the dead animal with slippery spittle and swallows it whole. If the prey is very large, such as a buck or wild pig, the snake will lie in the same place for a week or even more, digesting its food, during which time it is virtually incapable of defending itself. After some time at Wassoniro, we were joined by the Finlay family and their 7 children. Mr. Finlay had a transport business and based his 2 lorries at Wassoniro. These were Fords of 1.5 tons each, driven by Mr. Finlay and his driver. When he was old enough, his 2nd eldest son, Dennis, took over and drove one of the lorries. Dennis was a year older than I, and even at that age knew quite a bit about mechanics. In later years, although he had very little education, he became one of the best-known motor mechanics in southern Kenya. When he was not playing about inside engines or driving, Dennis, his brother Gary, and sister Peggy and I would always be together. A man called MacDonald turned up one day with a baby baboon and a young puppy which he gave me. However, for some reason or other, he insisted that it was bad luck to give away a monkey, so I paid him 6 pence and named the monkey Sumuni, which is the Swahili slang for 6 pence. Sumuni grew up to be an unusual character. Outside my mother's rondavel was a large fever tree in the fork of which we nailed an empty petrol box where Sumuni slept at night. After being with us for about 3 weeks, the little baboon had grown considerably and became a nuisance to people staying at the hotel, so he had to be tied up. Unfortunately, he would get his rope wrapped around branches of the tree, so Mr. Fisher put up a pole with the petrol box on top and a metal ring around the pole to which was attached Sumuni's rope. In this way, he did not get tangled up so often. He was also given a gunny bag with which he could cover himself at night, just like a human. At about this time, my mother, in partnership with Mr. Fisher, started a creamery. The Maasai women brought in milk to the creamery, where the cream was turned into clarified butter or ghee, and the separated milk fed to the pigs, which were kept as part of the scheme. While the women waited for the milk to be weighed, Sumuni would sometimes escape from his rope and immediately run over to them. He would ease up and pretend to take bugs and fleas from their heads, and as soon as they were relaxed, grab their skirts and run. On 2 or 3 occasions, he managed virtually to undress a woman. This raised a big laugh from the other women and the creamery staff, but no one lifted a finger to help the poor unclad woman. We found it great fun encouraging Sumuni to do this by giving him sweets and condensed milk, which, like me, he was very fond of each time he was successful. One night, when we were in bed, we heard him cry out. But before my mother could reach him, Sumuni had been killed by wild dogs. It was only a few nights after this that my mother, having worked late in the hotel, came into the room where I was sleeping and found a large black mamba curled up on the bottom of my bed. She was at first struck dumb and just stood and looked at it. When she came to her senses, she put the torch she had been carrying down on the dressing table, facing the snake, and slowly moved out of the room. A white hunter was staying at the hotel, and she ran to his rondavel for help. Carrying his shotgun, he and 2 of the servants entered our room. One of the Africans crept to the top of the bed and covered my head with the blankets, while the other knocked the snake to the floor with a long stick. The hunter shot the mamba and I woke in a terrible flight and started screaming, not knowing what was happening. Had I known, I would probably have screamed all the more. After quieting me down, the hunter told my mother that black mambas always lived in pairs and that the mate would be around looking for the dead snake. So it was decided that we would move to another rondavel. 2 days later, the maid did appear and was seen by one of the servants following what we assumed to be the same route as the first snake. Mr. Fisher shot it, and we returned to our old room. But I never felt the same in that rondavel again, and always looked carefully behind the cupboards and under the beds to see if there were any more snakes. We had been at Wassoniro a year or so when construction was started on what appeared to be, for that time and place, a very modern building. It was nearly 50 feet long by 17 feet wide, and was divided into 4 rooms, 2 small and 2 large. It was built of corrugated iron with ceilings and inside walls of Kavirondo matting. I learned that this was to be our new house. The 4 rooms were a living room, main bedroom for my mother and stepfather, a small room for me, and a bathroom. When the house was completed, my mother told me that she and Mr. Fisher were going up to Nairobi to be married and would not be back for 4 or 5 days. When they returned, Mr. Fisher would be my stepfather, and she would like me to call him father. At first, I felt a little embarrassed about this, but after a while it became quite natural, and as we got on very well together. Anyhow, it did not really mean anything to me whether he was my father or not. We remained good friends until he died, and I knew no other father. In conjunction with the hotel business, my parents kept a sizable herd of saddleback pigs. Part of their diet consisted of fresh meat fed to them twice a week from game shot on the plains. I usually accompanied my stepfather on these shooting trips, and once, just after the rains when the game was plentiful, my stepfather, 2 other men, Gary and I, went out in his box-body Chevrolet. A wild beast was wounded after several shots when it collapsed and was presumed dead. The car was driven up to it and my stepfather jumped out, but at that precise moment the wild beast got up and attacked him. He took cover behind the car, but it began to move forwards, driven by one of the other men. The wild beast, presumably seeing the movement of the vehicle, attacked it and ripped the toolbox off the side, getting its horn stuck in the aluminum outer cover of the box body. My stepfather grabbed a rifle from the car and shot it through the head. It then took over 30 minutes of hacking and pulling to dislodge the horn from the metal of the vehicle. Since then, I have had the greatest respect for these animals. Although they are supposed to be mild, I have on numerous occasions over the years been in situations where they showed a very fierce, belligerent streak. The same day we shot 4 wild beasts, a zebra and a Thompson's gazelle, and loaded them onto the lorry, which had been following behind. On our way home at dusk, we stopped to watch 2 herds of giraffe, which stood facing one another. From the centre of each herd, a male moved forward, and the 2 then began to fight, winding their necks round each other. Every now and then, one would give a sharp tug towards itself and throw the other off balance. It would then turn very fast and kick out as hard as it could, making contact with a loud thundering sound. One giraffe would then walk off, pursued by the other, and the battle would continue. Eventually, one was beaten, and it loped away, leaving the hero to be joined by all the females from both herds. The vanquished proceeded on its own until it was well out of sight. I saw these giraffes regularly for about a month after this. As they lived in the vicinity, and all the females and young remained with their new master throughout this time. One day, Jock MacDonald, who lived at Narosura near Barakitabu, stayed at the hotel. The next morning, he told my mother that he was taking me on safari with him for 2 days. Mac, as everyone called him, had in the past been notorious for his poaching activities. but at this particular time was employed by the game department to suppress poaching. We set off. After travelling for about an hour and a half, one of his two servants suddenly pointed to lots of large birds 2 miles out on the right. We immediately turned off the road and bounced over the open country, which was dotted with acacia trees. We soon found the reason for the vulture's presence. By the side of a dry river bed lay a dead wild beast with only its tail cut off, the rest of its body intact. Max swore and, talking to no one in particular, said he knew who the bastards were. In the next 2 hours, we found a total of 26 dead wildebeests in the area, all with their tails cut off. It was obvious that the culprits were not African, as car wheel tracks could be clearly seen. Also discarded passing show cigarette ends, and the fact that the animals had been shot with a rifle, all pointed to sophisticated poachers. Mac told me it was criminal and wasteful for people to slaughter animals and not make use of any part other than the tail, which was probably sold to make fly whisks. Among many of the tribes in East Africa, it was a status symbol to possess a wildebeest tail fly whisk. Depending on the social position of the individual, the whisk could be fitted onto a handle of ordinary wood, or of ebony, or ebony with beads, or in the case of a very superior chief or witch doctor, particularly amongst the Kikuyu, Maasai, and Kipsigis tribes, to an ivory handle. Also, the hairs from the long wildebeest tails were prized for the making of fine woven bangles, again to be worn by the upper hierarchy. There was, therefore, a fairly inexhaustible market for these tails. On reaching Mara, we went to a small rest house where we offloaded the game and left behind the two servants. One was given instructions to go and collect the game scouts, while the other man set up camp. Mac and I went to the river to fish, and that night we sat by a cheerful fire enjoying our afternoon's catch while Mac told me stories of shooting escapades on the Congo borders. Arab Koski, his turnboy cum driver, cook, mechanic and general factotum, also sat by the fire after serving our supper and competed in the storytelling. We slept in amongst the game, which let us know of their presence throughout the night. Hyena were attracted by the meat we had brought into camp, and lion roared across the river from one end to the other, followed by the yelping of jackal, which were hoping to pick up bits the lion had left behind. I was beginning to get quite used to animals in the daytime, but did not fancy the noises they made at night. As a result, I do not think I slept for 1 minute and kept waking Mac, who was competing solidly with the lion. In fact, I do not know which was the loudest, Mac's snoring or the lion's roaring. Next day, we were up early, breakfasted on fish and chips, and once again went along the river, this time with the car and the servants. After catching another 6 or 7 fish, we had tea at an Indian shop and then carried on home to Wassonyiro.